Record button. So I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Anu Pandey, who will be talking to us about podcasts as teaching aids for endangered language communities. And this is super, super exciting. So I'm really looking forward to this talk.
Should I start with the presentation?
Yes, please go ahead.
Hi everyone. So my name is Anu Pandey and I'm a PhD student in Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur. So today I want to talk about how we can use podcasts as teaching aids for endangered language communities. So first of all, I want to introduce the concept of podcasts. Podcasts are basically electronic media that have gained a lot of rapid popularity in the recent times. So we can define podcasts as basically their internet audio video. So they can be created using computers, microphones, as well as software programs. So once we create these podcasts, whether they're audio podcasts, video podcasts, or both audio video podcasts, we can access them through various kind of mobile applications, through computers and MP3 players. So the advantage of using this audio video visual medium is that they have very minimum technological requirements. It's like now it's a digital age. So we know that many people have access to computers and mobiles. So they can access these mediums, and it can also be used anytime and anywhere. Even when we are going for exercise or we are going for a walk, we can still listen to them. Many people do not enjoy reading that much, so they can make use of watching and listening to these podcasts. Now I want to highlight on the fact that podcasts can be an alternative to books as a mode of teaching. We know that books are traditionally used in schools and it's a traditional system of learning. But podcasts can use an alternative, and there are also several benefits of using them. In some communities, the electronic resources may be even more effective and useful than traditional texts. For example, Fang and Nathan, they had hypothesized that textbooks are not very fitting pedagogical tools for teaching an endangered community. And the reasons are, they often say that in many cases, the endangered community population is very small. So printing textbooks, and then it might not be very cost effective. Then there is also the issue of orthography. We do not have, most of the endangered community languages do not have a writing system. I mean, they have not been written down. And then we have to tackle the challenge of deciding on conflicting orthographies while creating a textbook for them. So these kinds of problems might not arise when we are using recorded podcasts. This concept of educational podcasting has recently come up. Jones has 2005 has remarked that these podcasts have been increasingly being used in education and language learning. For example, in there are PI casts which are being used in Scotland to teach to the school children various kinds of vocabulary revision exercises, listening exercises, and also interviews with non-native speakers. So they are being increasingly used now even in schools for teaching to children. The availability, it is also one of the reasons is that the students can easily make use of these podcasts through the MP3 players. They can also be downloaded and used through newspaper websites, blogs, and radio programs. and these can be listened anywhere and anytime. Its popularity is attributed to the reason that it encourages many students who dislike reading as much to study using these mediums. There are also some students who suffer from some kind of reading disability. They might also have some mental or visual impairment. So in such cases, podcast can be highly beneficial for these students. Education, when we talk about education, it's not only the traditional institutional learning, the education that is given to children in schools, but we have to also think about the adult education. The adult speakers of the community who might not have had access to the primary education, if you want to teach them, they do not have those skills of reading and writing. So books cannot be very helpful to teach them at this stage. But we can use podcasts. If we have recorded audiovisual episodes where we can teach them through these recordings, then it will be highly beneficial. It will also serve their vocational, personal, or recreational needs and foster their self-development. This has been remarked by Jeremy, 2014. Now, what are the advantages of podcasts for an endangered community? So I've already been talking about this. To elaborate on this, that podcasts, we can also use them for in schools, but it can be especially useful to the illiterate and the adult population of the endangered community who did not have access to the primary education. So it's not necessary that we have to depend on an academic institution or government to create podcasts. Group of linguists and native speakers, software developers, group of people can come together and they can create their own podcasts for the endangered speakers. We can also use data from the recordings and standard linguistic software such as ELAN, where various multimedia conversational materials, stories and songs that have been recorded, they can be converted into podcasts. Now, when we want to devise podcasts to help the endangered speakers, then we have to think of what kind of podcast can we create. So one of them can be, we can specifically create podcasts for teaching them the endangered language. So these podcasts should be specifically created for the intention of promoting the language teaching or learning. They should be in a very simplified language, and so that people can easily listen and use them. Such kind of teaching podcasts to foreign language learners are already being used, as Stanley has remarked, and they are assisted with transcripts of the taught language, which helps aids in the language learning of foreign language learners. So we can use this similar concept for the endangered language speakers also, to teach them the endangered language. Various podcasts exist that enable language learning of various prominent languages like speaking Russian and 30-minute Italian. So if you want to teach the grammar of the endangered language to the speakers, then we have to keep in mind the proficiency of different kinds of speakers. And we have to create grammar lessons moving from very basic to advanced lessons with most probably assisted by transcripts. Then another kind of podcast that we can create is creating podcasts which can create awareness about general issues among the endangered community speakers. So such podcasts should be created for giving them knowledge about things like health, sanitation, education, climate, news, etc. All these general issues of them, when the endangered speakers, the more they learn about these issues, it will improve their social and personal functioning. We also know that many of the endangered community speakers have a primary occupation, which is agriculture. So for instance, podcasts can be created which can assist them in farming techniques and how new farming issues, how the farming issues are there and what kind of technologies they can use for farming. So some farming podcasts are already being used in Australian farming. So the example include the Yarn and Actex or what. So similar kind of podcast we can create for the endangered community members. Then the third kind of podcast that can be created is for entertainment. Robert 2020 talks about the concept of fiction podcasts. So fiction podcasts are basically an artistic way of storytelling in the form of audiovisual drama. So they are kind of telling stories, serialized stories with continuous narratives in the form of various episodes. And they are used only for the purpose of leisure and entertainment, and they do not have any real informative content as per se. So we can make such podcasts ranging from different moods, genres and styles in the endangered language for the purpose of entertainment of the speakers. So one advantage of the fiction podcast will be that not only it will provide them a source of entertainment, but it will also help them to develop and foster learning and interest in the endangered language. Now we have to also tackle the challenge of what should be the medium of instruction for the podcasts when we are creating. So should they be monolingual, bilingual? This we have to think about. A monolingual podcast. We can obviously create monolingual podcast by identifying and obtaining authentic materials from that community. The original texts, their films, histories, and recordings, they all can be used to create monolingual podcasts. But then there will be certain drawbacks if you are creating monolingual podcasts. One of them is that if you want that this language should also be promoted, and the non-native speakers should also learn this language, then they cannot access this language if we are creating monocast podcast, especially in the endangered language. So it will restrict the audience of that podcast. And if certain community members of the endangered community are not very proficient in that language, suppose they are bilingual and they do not have a lot of proficiency in the endangered language, they might not be able to utilize the monolingual podcasts. Then we can, the other alternative is to create a bilingual podcast. So if we create a bilingual podcast, we can say that one of the languages can be the endangered language and another can be English, since English is a global language. So this, the advantage of this is that people who are non-native speakers of the language can also learn the endangered language. So we can, this will help in promoting the endangered language and people will start appreciating and it will increase the prestige of that endangered language. So, and it will promote the language among non-native population also. But then English, many endangered speakers are do not know English. They might belong to some rural areas or isolated areas where they have not learned English, and they might be bilingual in some other major dominant language like German, French, Hindi, whatever. So then we can create a bilingual podcast having one of the languages as an endangered language and another can be the dominant language. So the advantage of this is that if even if the endangered speaker is proficient, is partially proficient in the endangered language, and he that person knows the dominant language, so he will be able to utilize that podcast. So even when we are thinking of making these podcasts, we have to face certain challenges. So one of the challenges that we'll face is how will we choose the language structures if we find a lot of variation in the language of the endangered community. So if we think of the variation and we say that the variation is very limited in certain structures, then we might mention the variation side by side in the recordings and keep it as such. But if we find a widespread variation, then we can choose to stick with the most popular variants, which are being used by the majority of the people. So this will be one of the challenges of tackling the variation. Then another challenge will be there are definitely some endangered communities which are very remote or isolated, and they might not have very good internet connectivity issues, where they can even if they subscribe the podcast through mobiles, they might not have a very smooth usage of these podcasts, and when they listen and use the podcast, it might break the connectivity. So these things we have to be kept in mind, but it will obviously be useful for many other communities which have good technological support. So I will give you an example of podcast that is being used in India. So this podcast has been created by the Endangered Language Network in India by a group of linguists which are basically interested in language conservation. This involves a lot of the community members, various language activists, and even the veteran field workers. And they come together and they discuss about the language documentation issues, the endangerment and revitalization issues. So this is an example of podcast that is being used in India. So lastly, I want to conclude that the concept of podcasts belongs to a new wave of teaching, just like Skype, which will be quite different from the traditional method of books. They can be effective teaching aids, not only for the children, but also specifically focusing on the adult population of the endangered community, where other pedagogical tools might not help a lot. So we can predict that if we introduce podcast teaching, it will empower language learning among the endangered language speakers, promoting their identity, and will also help dissipate the negative language attitudes that they have towards their language. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anu. I'll hand over to you, Chris. We started on time, so I'll let you take over.
Okay. I apologize. I wasn't able to. I didn't realize I had to reconnect to Zoom, so I missed the first couple of sentences. Anyway, there is a question from Sarah Round, which I have here. Can I ask, if we consider a bilingual podcast, is there also an issue of when to use each language, i.e. other implied meaning based on the use of code switching between the two languages? Would you like to answer that, Anu?
Yes, sir. If you consider a bilingual, what I suggest is that if it is a bilingual, then there will be side by side translation of the languages. I did not get this question exactly, the concept of code switching.
She implies bilingual podcasts. You did mention in your talk bilingual podcasts, and she wondered which language would be appropriate in each particular case. Is there an answer to that?
So, but bilingual means that we are using both languages, two languages at the same time.
Okay, yeah. So I don't suppose the question really arises then. We have another question from Manuel here. He asks, may he ask for links to YouTube podcast or any podcast you highly recommend to learn languages and to and endangered languages learning information? And while we're on that subject, I was going to ask, would you say that the podcasts in endangered languages are particularly popular in any particular part of the world? You spoke generally about the podcasts, but are they particularly popular in India rather than other countries, do you think?
Yes, sir. The podcasts are being used in other countries mm-hmm. also, and in India also being used. It has not been employed till now. As of I have not found that it is being used for endangered language teaching, but it has been used for teaching of dominant languages like Russian, and like I mentioned in my presentation also, speaking Russian and Italian, 30 yes. minutes Italian. So similar kind of podcast we can create. Endangered language speakers yeah. also.
Okay, we've got time for some more questions, and we have them. Here's one from Emine Shahengoz. I also have a question. In a community where podcasts are not known or not popular yet, how can we introduce them? I guess she means we linguists.
That is a very good question. If people are not aware of the concept of podcasts, then someone has to, even some linguist or someone has to go and make them, aware. If you're doing documentation in that area, we can make them more aware of how they can use their language and how they can use podcasts for learning their language.
Okay.
So it will be like giving back to the community.
Yeah. Okay. I have a long one here from Jeanette, who asks, can you give a brief description of an example of using a podcast in teaching the endangered language in a classroom? Would it be the full class or just a segment of the class? Or is this suggested for teaching the endangered language using technology? Or it would be good to mix the podcast with normal classroom books and face-to-face teaching. And she compliments you on your interesting paper. Can you answer that in a simple way?
Yes, what I have been proposing is that we can definitely use this podcast for teaching the children in schools, and it is already being used for educational podcasting in many countries like Scotland, where vocabulary revision exercises, etc. are being used. So it is an alternative to books. I mean, they can use both books and they can also use podcasts. And besides that, it can also be used for the adult speakers, teaching the adult speakers. Right now, I don't know of any podcast that is already being used for teaching endangered language in classroom. Mm-hmm. So I cannot. Okay.
Yeah, okay. Ugorji asks a question. You're provoking a lot of questions. Is it possible to have practical steps in constructing podcasts as part of this lecture?
This is a work in progress, and I have not thought of exactly how will I go about creating podcasts.
Okay.
But it is definitely, you have to record and use, that I have to work on that.
Yeah. And thank you. Okay. It's a work in progress. We have two comments from Peter Austin, which I'll read out. Podcasts are asynchronous, so learners can listen to them at any time, like streaming TV programs. That's their great advantage, it seems to me. And he also says there are other advantages that they do not require literacy. Yeah, well, that's a point that you made, yes. We've got another time for one more question. Simona Scuri asks, hi, thanks, very interesting. Also on Telegram, podcasts are very popular here in Italy. There you are.
I see. I was not aware of this, and I will definitely.
Oh, they're probably popping up everywhere. Okay, well, thank you very much, Anu. You provoked a lot of thought and a lot of questions from your listeners. And it was very interesting. And I'm sorry I missed the beginning. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
I'll hand you back to Rita now.